Good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting of Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have apologies this morning from Pam Duncan-Glancy. Philip McGregor and Karen Adam are joining us virtually. Our first agenda item is to consider whether to take item 5 on correspondence from the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in private. Is that agreed? That is. Thank you. Okay, moving straight on then to agenda item 2, which is a roundtable evidence session on family law disputes between parents about the care of their children. And I welcome to the meeting, joining us remotely, Judith Higson, Child and Family Law Subcommittee of the Law Society of Scotland, Leslie Anderson, Chair of the Family Law Association, Dr. Marcia Scott, Chief Executive, Scottish Women's Aid, and joining us in person, I welcome Ruth Innes, QC, Faculty of Advocates, Megan Farr, Policy Officer, Children and Young People's Commissioner, Scotland, Ian Maxwell, National Manager, Shared Parenting Scotland, and Roseanne Cubitt, Head of Practice for Family Mediation and Relationship Counselling, Relationship Scotland. You're all very welcome. I refer members to papers 1, 2 and 3, and I invite each of the participants to make a very brief opening statement, starting with our witnesses in the room. Can I ask Ruth Innes, please? Sorry.
I couldn't remember. On behalf of the faculty, thank you very much for inviting us to attend today's roundtable discussion. The faculty was obviously engaged in responding to the consultation in advance of the 2020 Act and has since then responded to the consultation in respect of child welfare reporters and also the recent Scottish Civil Justice Council consultations in relation to rules in respect of mode of attendance at court hearings. In respect of the pandemic, it's generally felt that in family cases, the courts have made every effort to keep cases moving, irrespective of the difficulties which have been occasioned. As we hopefully move forward, we've welcomed the recognition in the SEJC consultation that family hearings, other than those of a purely procedural nature, are best dealt with in person, albeit preserving the option for remote hearings or for evidence to be taken remotely if that's appropriate, for example, if a party is a vulnerable witness. One of the concerns strongly expressed by members of faculty is the ongoing use of telephone hearings, which has been found to be unsatisfactory in a number of respects. In relation to child welfare reporters, the faculty responded to the Scottish Government consultation last year. Obviously, we are of the view that more training and a more regulated system is to be welcomed. However, our general view is that it should continue to be managed by the courts. In terms of challenges facing parents and children, I know others will highlight other issues, so I just want to highlight one issue, which is the difficulty in accessing therapeutic input or expert psychological support. I think that's an issue that affects families and young people in general, but not just in cases before the court, but that's simply, I think, an issue to be highlighted.
Thank you very much. Can I ask Megan, please?
Thank you. My name's Megan Farr and I'm a Policy Officer for the Children and Young People's Commissioner Scotland. The Commissioner's role is to promote and safeguard the human rights of children and young people in Scotland, with particular attention to the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child. We provided evidence to the former Justice Committee regarding the Children Scotland Act 2020 at both stage 1, 2 and 3, and we also provided oral evidence on that. Continue to be concerned, as Ruth reports, around the impact of virtual hearings on children and young people, and particularly on their right to participate in proceedings when their decisions are being made about them.
Thank you. And Ian?
Thank you very much for inviting Shared Parenting Scotland to this event. COVID and lockdown created many issues and challenges for separated parents and their children. In some cases, communication between separated parents improved as they worked together against the pandemic, Unfortunately, for many others, communication just stopped along with contact. Closure of courts and contact centres caused massive delays to the progress of cases. While we appreciate the efforts of so many within the courts and support services to catch up, what's often referred to as a backlog of cases, to us this could mean the loss of months or years of relationship between a child and one of their parents. We welcomed the initial triaging of family cases that started when the courts were closed. This was used to identify urgent business, for example, if contact was being unreasonably withheld. We appreciate the efforts made by so many within the system to get back to something like normal as soon as possible, but we feel COVID highlighted to us just how unsatisfactory normal is in Scotland. It is slow, unpredictable, inconsistent between courts, and shockingly expensive. In the name of seeking the best interests of the child, our adversarial system pits parents against each other, precisely when they need maximum help in focusing on what will be best for their children next week, next year, and into adulthood. Now that we've had a taste of it, a form of early triaging could inject a sense of urgency into the whole court system. Months of a child's life shouldn't be allowed to slip by because the system is slow. The Cochem Family Court in Germany found that such a radical change worked very well. Cases there have a first hearing in 2 weeks, not 2 months. This would allow contact to restart as soon as possible, the best outcome for the child, in a contact centre if there's concern about safety or abuse, but unsupervised where there's no such concern. The COVID time has revealed what a blunt instrument our system is. But the will to try something new during the restrictions should be continued. Separating parents need to be supported to help their children cope with the new arrangements, not punished by having to go to court. We've just launched New Ways for Families, which is a combination of online training and one-to-one coaching that gives parents the skills to problem solve on their own account. Relationship Scotland already offer Parenting Apart training sessions. 44% of civil legal aid is spent on family cases, a total of £57 million per year. Increasing the amount spent on supporting and training separated parents to reach agreement would save lots of money on family court actions. It would help them and above all their children to enjoy the benefits of shared parenting. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And now, Rosanne.
Good morning. So I'm Head of Practice at Relationship Scotland. We're a network of 21 member services providing a range of support to families with relationship difficulties. So in the context of family law, we work with families with issues arising from separation and divorce, contact and residence disputes. This is primarily through family mediation, which helps parents to discuss and agree arrangements for the care of their children, and through the provision of child contact centres that support children to have a relationship with the parent or carer that they no longer live with. We also offer counselling for adults, children and young people, and, as Ian said, parent education sessions, which we call Parenting Apart. So we welcome this opportunity to give feedback to the committee about the general issues in this area of work and about the impact of the pandemic. I've sought feedback from our member agencies that provide mediation, child contact and Parenting Apart. A number of themes are recurring and have actually been recurring for many years and remain an issue. We would summarise these as adequate risk assessment prior to court orders being made to ensure that cases that are referred, particularly for child contact, are appropriate. We do a risk assessment in terms of provision of the service, but further up the line, the court is making an order and the question is whether that contact order is appropriate. So adequate risk assessment prior to a court order being made. Secondly, realistic court orders that reflect what can be provided on the ground. So orders are sometimes made for a frequency of contact or on a timescale that can't be achieved with the resources available. So greater communication with the provision on the ground would be helpful for families. So communication and information that we get from the court, particularly to allow the Child Contact Centre to then make their assessment of supporting that action. Some courts only send the order, some send reports and assessments, which can be really helpful. And hearing children's views, we have a really strong view that this is really specialist work and it's critical that it's undertaken by skilled workers. And not all of those who are doing this work have undertaken adequate training, particularly in terms of trauma, safeguarding child development. In terms of the pandemic and the resulting delays that others have alluded to in the court process, particular issues for families have been much longer breaks for children not seeing their parents. So re-establishing those relationships takes longer and is harder. Escalated and more entrenched conflict, so they've had longer in that adversarial process, so that takes longer to de-escalate. Significantly more mental health issues and anxieties for children, for parents, and actually for practitioners as well. We're seeing practitioners needing a lot more support for what they've had to deal with through the pandemic. And longer waiting lists for child contact support because of the need for more cleaning, fewer families, lack of venue availability. So our child contact centre support does have longer waiting lists. We've adapted our practice so we can offer mediation on Zoom. So that's working well. We don't have waiting lists for mediation, but direct work with children is less effective on video conferencing technology, and it's important for children to actually spend time with the other parent in person. So a broader point to conclude is that a range of support can be provided by Relationship Scotland that is holistic, therapeutic, impartial, not connected with the court process, and if families were referred much earlier, prior to the escalation of conflict through the court system, we would be able to work with them and provide an integrated package of support that would be a cost saving to the public purse. And it actually works well alongside the legal process if they need a determination. In terms of the secondary legislation, we submitted detailed responses to the various consultations and contribute to meetings with the Scottish Government. We're supportive of all the developments that have been raised in the secondary legislation. And I guess our main frustration is really the delay to the implementation of the pilot of ADR information meetings. So we appreciate it's not a top priority and COVID has impacted on the progress of that. But there is a danger of it being overly complicated and unnecessarily delayed. Thank you.
OK, thank you. Now, moving to our remote witnesses, can I ask Judith, please?
Hello, good morning. Thank you for inviting the Law Society's Subcommittee on Child and Family Law to give evidence today. We've also responded to most of the consultations mentioned by Ruth Innes QC. We consider it important to look at matters on a case-by-case basis, looking at any individual child's needs and to look for flexible and creative solutions to assist families and obviously parents in dispute. We also consider it very important not to put responsibility for decision making onto children. The decision makers obviously need to understand things from the child's point of view, but asking children to make the decisions themselves is too much responsibility. Our sort of general theme really is that we already have a lot of legislation to achieve what we consider to be our desired goals. We don't need to reinvent the wheel, and we can look at the legislation we have and adapt that. We support the regulation of child contact centres and the regulation of welfare reporters. We welcome the work being done on ADR. Generally, access to support and funding are important to consider. And some more specific challenges which we've seen as a result of the pandemic are examples of, examples of parents using the pandemic to, for instance, act belligerently, withhold contact time from the other parent. We've seen some parents cooperate better than others. Some parents may have been shielding, and there have been instances of disputes and differences of opinion arising over the necessity of those types of situation. Parents have also had to consider the position of vulnerable grandparents and how to manage children's time with them safely. And that may have impacted on the other parent's time with the child, and disputes have arisen from that. Some parents have lost the support of childcare provided by grandparents who have become vulnerable because of the pandemic. There have been occasions when parents have been more likely to look for alternative solutions as opposed to going to court as a result of the potential for delays in raising court proceedings caused by the pandemic. Also, there are challenges, you know, with the court system, just in terms of solicitors getting papers from the court when representing parties or children. The solicitor's ability to communicate with the Sheriff Clerk's office was severely impacted, and evidential hearings have been challenging as everybody grappled with the technology. There's been impacts on trainee solicitors in terms of them getting exposure to the court system, and solicitors have been advised by certain jurisdictions not to contact the court for updates in cases because of a lack of staff at work as a result of them requiring to self-isolate or being unwell. So I'll leave it there for now. That's probably enough for an opening statement, and I can flesh out anything as required. Thank you very much.
Thank you. If we can now go to Leslie, please.
Good morning, and thank you for the invitation. I appear today as Chair of the Family Law Association, which is a network of family law practitioners across Scotland. We have around 350 members. The Family Law Association provides training to family law solicitors, also has responded to the consultations mentioned by Ruthinna's QC. We also provide a forum and a mechanism for information sharing across the members in terms of updates in family law. That's my voluntary work. My day job, I'm a solicitor advocate who's accredited as a specialist in child law and separately family law. I'm a court-appointed child welfare reporter, curatrix ad litem and reporting officer. I've also written articles on the development of the court process through COVID and also advocacy in the virtual court. One of the things that has been on my radar very much has been what I would call a swell in COVID contact cases, both in terms of being a solicitor advocate appearing for parties, but also as a child welfare reporter, and all the issues particularly mentioned by Ian, I very much agree with in terms of there's a huge gap for children in being able to see one or other of their parents because of COVID. The other thing that's really at the forefront is interviewing children. So I'm interviewing children at least once a week as a child welfare reporter and as a curatrix, and being asked to interview younger and younger children in respect to their views being available to the court to take account of in terms of making decisions. So thank you for the opportunity to give evidence this morning.
Thank you. And finally, going to Marcia, please.
Good morning. I'm really delighted to be invited to speak about these issues, which are of supreme importance. So I'm Marshall's Chief Executive Scottish Women's Aid, and we are both a women's rights organization and a children's rights organization. So we care very much about the outcomes of some of the questions on today's agenda. And I will also be appearing tomorrow morning to give evidence to the Criminal Justice Committee and some of its discussions. And I think this really points out one of our concerns about the new arrangements of committees after the previous election, which is there seems to be both a good and a bad, I suppose, outcome, which is my concerns are that civil law and criminal law, and I understand the workload issues involved, have been separated. And one of the strongest concerns we have about the way Scotland's justice system operates for children is that there is a chasm between criminal and civil justice procedures, which means that information from criminal cases involving domestic abuse and harm and trauma to children and their mothers very rarely makes its way, information from those cases very rarely makes its way efficiently and robustly into civil hearings around child contact. So we have been trying very hard to bridge that chasm by having children identified as co-victims in criminal cases. We failed to get that into the new domestic abuse law, and there is an ongoing problem that having them considered separately by two different committees, we are worried, will exacerbate. However, if it means that there is more attention being paid to civil justice because a different committee has gotten it, we're all happy about that, all over that, as I would say. So I welcome the committee's invitation and its interest in contact centers, et cetera, in part because the vast majority of women who contact the Scottish Women's Rights Center, Scottish Women's Aid, and a variety of civil legal aid offices do so. Domestic abuse survivors are domestic abuse cases that are engaging in child contact processes. So this is an absolutely critical issue, and I hope you forgive me because I do have a few things to say about it. First of all, I find myself in the very unusual circumstance of agreeing with Ian Maxwell, and I want to say that I too do not understand the system's desires to rush back to a status quo that was totally unacceptable prior to COVID in terms of face-to-face and virtual proceedings and delays in the system and a whole variety of other systemic problems that deny children their human rights. And I think it's worth pointing out that in my view and in our view, the entire civil justice system around family law needs to be reframed in terms of CRC, the Convention on the Rights of the Child, and in terms of Scotland's obligations to actually allow children to realize their human rights. And I'll just point out that if you look at the attendees at this panel, we're a children's rights organization. I'm very delighted to see Megan from the Children's Commissioner's Office, but that is the extent of the representation of children's rights on this panel. So I would just ask for reflection upon that. I wish to point out that I want to challenge the assumptions in a number of the speakers before me that shared parenting and or child contact could always be assumed to be a positive impact on children's lives. And I'll talk a little bit about what the children that we serve tell us about how the system operates. And I think it's probably worth saying that we really need to scrutinize our system because we are still operating, even though perhaps not formally, but informally, as if children are at best irrelevant in these proceedings and at worst collateral damage. And in some senses, we still treat them as property, often as property of their father. So we need to be willing to challenge the assumptions that have operated for hundreds of years in our civil processes. So I think at the moment, it would be really worth pointing out that the elephant in the room often in discussions about access to justice is the availability of legal services, which COVID has very much exacerbated for children and also for their mothers in domestic abuse cases. And I can tell you that there's a crisis at the moment, especially from our services in Highlands and Islands, about getting access, not even just to legal aid lawyers, but to solicitors in general to help them in civil cases. I like to call it that we have a great access to injustice system. And I would like to point out that the government has accepted recommendations, both from the improving women and children's housing outcomes, women and children who are experiencing domestic abuse report, and from the National Advisory Council on Women's and Girls recommendations that women and children living with domestic abuse be offered free legal services and representation. And we're not really seeing much action on that. I think that I would hope that the committee would pick that up and pursue it. So I'm going to ask the committee a question that I think is really important for us to think about and answer over the next years of this parliament. And it was posed by a child in one of our services, and I will point to our consultation response, which was extensive and based on consultation with mothers and children and service providers in terms of the contact center consultation. So one of the children asked, do children have a right to end an abusive relationship? And clearly in Scotland, they do not at this moment. And we have the persistence, my utter frustration, of this notion that there is something called parental alienation, which masquerades in the consultation as understanding the way adults can influence a child. No idea how that got in there, especially given that parental alienation has been taken off the World Health Organization's list of child abuses for lack of evidence. That we had 14 academics from across the UK wrote to the cabinet, previous cabinet secretary for justice, explaining how parental alienation charges in child contact cases serve to silence and exacerbate and re-traumatize the existing power differential and the outcomes of abuse, with no creditable evidence in research literature. And we know in Spain they have outlawed the use of parental alienation and similar claims in child contact cases. And yet it pops up again in the government's consultations. So I think it would be of interest to ask if we wanted to look at training on understanding how adults interact with children, why we're not asking understanding the perpetrators' behaviors and how that impacts children, understanding how non-offending parents work to protect their children. These are all a number of sort of strengths-based approaches to helping child contact center staff do their job. So I would encourage the committee to see below some of the assumptions about what parents might be doing to protect or abuse their children. Okay. And I'll read to you one quick thing, and then I'll finish with a statement from the children that gave evidence to the Justice Committee. In our consultation of 2021, a woman spoke of a child, quote, having to be ripped from her arms by contact center staff, her child clutching contact staff who she hardly knew and refusing to let go when brought into the room with her dad. She then overheard her child screaming in another room during contact. Since she has been accused by her ex-partner of alienating in court, she'd been accused of alienating the child from him, she then felt unable to voice wholly legitimate concerns about how she and her child had been treated, about the impact on her child, about her fear of the response from the staff, should she complain, and her silencing when feeling the need to seek protection for her child. And finally, a statement from one of our young experts in a European project that we did on court-ordered child contact. It was quite hard to tell the child welfare reporter how I felt. The first one was strict and polite, but not smiley. When she came to my dad's house to ask me how my day went, I would say out loud that it was fun. But I would try to nudge her and hint to her that I won't be able to tell the truth in my dad's house. But she ignored it. My dad told me that he wanted me to give him a hug, even though I didn't like him, and I did it anyway. But the court reporter wrote in her report that I was happy to give him a hug. She didn't see what was really going on. When I would tell her later on, she would say that I was lying. She would interrupt me and stop me from talking, and then I would stutter and not be able to say what I wanted or how I felt.
Okay, thank you very much. We're now going to move to questions. I'll ask members to indicate who they're, obviously the seven panel members, so indicate who they want to answer the questions. Clearly, if other people want to come in, if you could indicate, and I'll try and bring people in. The aim is that to have a bit of a discussion. We'll try and intersperse hearing views of the panel with questions from the committee. If we move on and you still have something to say that you've heard earlier, then please take the opportunity to make sure you're getting your point on the record. It's quite a big panel, so my chairing will not be seamless. It's just too difficult. Otherwise, we'd be here all day. We're going around every single member for every single comment. And I guess the other thing I would say is this is a starting point for the committee in this area, and we'll look at everything we hear today and then decide what more we want to do. So to kick questions off, can I go to Maggie Chapman, please?
Thanks very much, Joe, and good morning to everybody. Thank you for joining us and for your opening remarks. You've covered a lot of ground and a lot of different issues, and I suppose I was struck by what both Ian and Marcia said around that the old normal really isn't good enough. It's not satisfactory. It's not working for anybody. And I wonder if maybe Ian, you could say a little bit more, and Megan, I'll bring you in as well, if that's okay. Just around some of the experiences of why the pandemic has shown just how bad the old normal was, and what it is that we can perhaps think of doing better. And one of the things that is in all of this for me is that conflict, that tension between the welfare of the child and their rights to be heard, their rights to have their views expressed. And I'd just be interested in how you balance those experiences with those that welfare versus rights conflict, or how I perceive it as a conflict. Thank you.
Yes, this is something that's been touched on a couple of times in the evidence so far. And obviously the implementation of the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, assuming it does happen, will make quite a big difference to a lot of public authorities, because they realise that they will have to take children more seriously. One of the things that happens at the moment is that sometimes sheriffs will write letters to children, will tell children what's happened. We feel that this should happen in almost every case where a significant decision is made in court. The child needs to be informed directly and in child-friendly language. Some sheriffs can do this, and we would also like to see all judgments in court cases published, because there's a lot of, obviously in an anonymous form so that the individuals concerned are not sort of labelled by it, but the judgments that are made in court are often very difficult ones. And I'm thinking of one that I read from last year, where after a lot of detailed consideration, the sheriff concluded that a child had been adversely influenced by the resident parent, who happened to be the mother but could have been the father, and that the child's rejection of their father, of her father, was not justified. But because the child was old enough to have a very firm view of what she wanted at the moment, the judgment wasn't to force her to go back to see that parent. But the sheriff did write a letter to that child saying, I feel that your father has a lot of qualities which you're not seeing at the moment, and hopefully in time you will have a coffee with him, we'll get back. Now, that judgment was a very interesting example of what can happen in family courts, and it is the court is taking a very detailed look. Now, but what we would like to say is that plenty of cases should never have to go that far in court. Most family court cases don't go beyond child welfare hearings, and child welfare hearings by and large are inquisitorial rather than adversarial, although obviously they're conducted with lawyers on both sides. We feel that moving to an inquisitorial system for Scottish courts, having quicker triaging, because the child does not want to wait months and months before a decision is made about whether or not they can see the other parent. The longer the child has to not see the parent, the more likely it is that the child will think there's something wrong that'll be more difficult for the child to get back in touch. And yes, the court needs to protect children as well. The court is not meant to be exposing children to risks. The children, and I don't think the court tries not to, but we do need training and support for people like child welfare reporters, which is contained in the regulation plans that are coming through from the Children Scotland Act. But, so a lot is happening that is good, but we feel that now is the time to have a really radical look at how we handle family cases, which are quite different from most of the other cases that come up in court. They are about the welfare of children, and we need to have a different approach to them.
Thanks, Ian. Megan, do you want to?
Thanks. I feel slightly at a disadvantage for having taken the request for a short opening statement, perhaps overly literally. The rights within the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child are interlinked, and they shouldn't be seen as individual rights, but what needs to be considered is the way that they interact with each other. So the right to maintain contact with both parents, or all parents, and with the extended family, has to be considered, and also in the light of the right for the child to be kept safe. It's that the two need to be balanced. The other right that we've talked to a lot about, but haven't yet named, is Article 12, which is often expressed as the right to have a view, and to have that view heard. It's actually more than that. It's a right for that view to be given due weight, and that can be quite considerable weight. It doesn't mean making children responsible for decision making, but it means making the adults who make decisions responsible for listening to the views of the child and giving them due weight. It's also, Article 12 is also a right to participate. And one of the ways that private law, I think, has hung behind other parts of the justice system, and particularly the ASN Tribunal and the Children's Hearing System, is the way that those systems put the child at the centre and allow the children opportunities to actively participate in a way that's appropriate to them. There's a lot of good practice going on there to develop those settings' ability to allow children to participate. There's a lot of good things that were achieved by the 2020 Act. It goes a long way, but it still hasn't really put in place a system that allows that. One of the issues that's still outstanding is children's lack of standing in a dispute between their parents. So even if a child, and it may be an older child, but even if a child wants to actively participate themselves, they often can't. They also face barriers around, and we've heard it around adults facing these barriers. Children have that even more so, is around finding a lawyer who will represent them or even advise them, and also obtaining legal aid, because legal aid is still means tested, even if the child is trying to exercise their rights autonomously, that legal aid is still means tested on the basis of parental income. So those barriers, the children still don't have the opportunity to exercise those rights if they want to. I'm not suggesting it be compulsory for a child to be a party to a dispute about them, but they should have that opportunity. In terms of the cases that reach the court, I think one of the ongoing themes through the 2020 Act when we were talking about that was actually recognising that a small minority of cases actually reach the court. A lot are dealt with amicably between parents or with the assistance of people like Relationship Scotland. The very small number that do reach the court, by definition, there's a conflict. If there wasn't a conflict, no one would be spending money taking things to court. So in terms of children's involvement, it becomes all the more important to properly understand their views. And some of the examples we hear around the way that children are talked about in courts suggests that although views are being sought, they're not necessarily being given the weight they need. Suggestions that children can be unduly influenced, a real concern that suggests that actually it's a way of dismissing children's opinions when they're inconvenient. Finally, in terms of mediation, we're supportive of alternative dispute resolution and mediation. It's really important to reduce to an absolute minimum the number of cases that reach the court, but I think there's still varied practice in terms of how children are visible in that process as well, and how children's views are there. That's a gap that we didn't address. I think Rosanna's organisation and other people involved in mediation are working on that, but I think there's still probably work to do in allowing children the right to participate in that process as well when decisions are made that are affecting their entire life.
Thank you.
Yeah, would that be all right?
Would that be helpful?
Yeah, so just on that last point, we do, within Relationship Scotland, our family mediation process, we have our mediators do additional training to consult with children. So we have that established set-up process, so children can participate, have their views heard, and those views are fed back to the parents in mediation to influence or to inform their decision making. So it's very much still the parents' decision, but the children have an opportunity to express their views.
Thanks. Can I follow up? Thanks very much for that. I'm interested in, and maybe this is my lack of the knowledge of the complete landscape here, but Megan, you seem to be speaking a little bit about actually the challenge of infantilization and not taking children as human beings of their own minds and that kind of thing, and using that as a pawn in some ways in some of these cases, maybe more so where there is actual conflict, as you say, the ones that go to court. And I'm wondering whether there is whether there is work we need to be thinking about around, I don't think everything can be solved with training, but I think that there's something around training around what trauma means. There's something around training around what capabilities are, and capabilities will change within an individual, never mind, you know, over a group of people as they grow up. But I just wondered if you could say a little bit more about those kinds of issues that we need to be able to get at here.
First of all, this is absolutely not something that is exclusive to civil justice or to any of these processes. It's an issue, I think, across society, where we still look at children in a way that, as you, to use your word, infantilizes them to an extent. We underestimate their capacity to express their views, to have sensible decision. When we discuss it, people start using worst-case examples. I think I've probably done that myself in the past, and say, you know, well, if a three-year-old says they want to be an astronaut, they might, you know, that's not possible. It's like, well, actually, it might be. But also, that doesn't mean that three-year-old can't have really sensible views about what's important to them or who are important to them or what they want to happen in their life. There is the thing in Article 12 about due weight, but I think sometimes that's used as an excuse to not... talks about age and maturity, it's used as an excuse to exclude. Presumption should be, and actually the presumption we have in the 2020 Act does work like this, and that's a massive improvement, but the presumption should be that the child can express their views and have them taken into account, and then there's quite a high bar to say why they shouldn't. It should be a rare thing. Now, the due weight is useful in terms of when you have very small children who don't necessarily clearly express their views. And it's also a way of, to draw on Judith's point, not making the child responsible for the decision. But actually, when due weight means that what the child has said isn't what's going to happen, that needs to, goes back to Ian's point, that needs to be communicated back to them in a sensitive way by the system, not necessarily the sheriff or but by someone who can explain that to them. And one of the discussions in when the Act was being considered was, or a parent, and actually no, don't put parents in that role either. It's not, that needs to be done in a way that's sensitive to that child. I mentioned the presumption, and I think actually that's been one of the real positives, and that's part of trying to generate the culture change, and it's the sort of culture change we're talking about in terms of incorporation of UNCRC as well, is that what we heard previously was that 12 became a magic cutoff because the presumption was from 12. And you'd have families in which each child progressively was... contact orders were ended when the child reached 12, but the younger siblings were still... having to attend contact until they reach 12. So that's been a real positive. But it's not just a justice thing. It's about how all of us as society consider children and their views and opinions. And I think we're well on that road now. We have started all that work. But it's not going to be instant. And this Act was a part of actually changing that.
Thank you.
Thanks, Joe. Okay, thank you. Can I go to Pam Gossall, please?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel, and thank you for your opening remarks. In the written evidence provided, it said that Shire courts still don't seem to be equipped with WebEx for the child welfare hearings, and parents aren't being included in the WebEx child welfare hearings. Are you confident that the children are being heard in child welfare hearings? and with the coronavirus recovery bill, would see remote hearings potentially extended until 2023. How do you think this would impact the rights of parents and children to be heard in child welfare hearings? And can my question go to Ian?
Yeah.
Yes, we were actually very surprised to hear recently that the Glasgow Sheriff Court for Child Welfare Hearings isn't even managing to get WebEx. They're just still doing them by phone. And that's the biggest sheriff court in Scotland. And it also has got a very good team of family sheriffs. It's been a massive change. And it was actually good that the courts got WebEx and then got telephone conferences and WebEx up and running. But now that we've had them, we need to be moving faster back towards having people sitting down in court so that the sheriff can see them, so they can see each other, and so that they can see the sheriff. Because the sheriff's influence on parents who aren't managing to agree, the sheriff needs to give them a sort of push them towards agreement, in a sense. So we would be really keen, and I think quite a few of the lawyers in this group would also be keen, for family hearings to resume as soon as possible face-to-face in court. But what you're also asking about is children. Despite the name, very few children, if any, appear in child welfare hearings. Now, there's a degree of protection here that you don't want to be taking children into court. But you do need their views, and I think finding ways that children's views can be communicated. At the moment, it can be through a form F9, it can be through the sheriff speaking to the child, it can be through the child welfare reporter, it can be through intervention of a Relationship Scotland child consultation. There's so many different ways. Each court does it differently. In Germany, children have a right to speak to a judge, but only the judges who've done training in listening to children are allowed to handle that. We have some training like this in Scotland, but by no means every sheriff who talks to a child has gone through training. So there's a lot of change that can happen, and I think we use the learning from the COVID problems to move us forward, along with all the law changes and the other things that have been implemented.
Thank you. Thank you.
Ruth, I wonder, would you want to come in on this?
Yes, as I indicated at the outset, we certainly are of the view that telephone hearings are not an acceptable mode of hearing. People are excluded, including parties to the action, and it's not an open way of dealing with matters. So there have been a lot of benefits from doing the virtual hearings and doing WebEx hearings, and even in respect of speaking to children, I also do work as a child welfare reporter. And obviously the core of your work would be seeing the child face to face, but the ability to have a Zoom communication with the child before you meet them face to face, so that they know who they're meeting, to enable them to communicate with you, I suppose, more freely and more in a manner that they would be used to, is something that's opened up and I think can be used a bit more.
Thanks for that. And I think Megan, you were wanting to come in as well.
I agree with the concern about virtual hearings continuing. I think particularly for issues around children and young people, that's really concerning that they're going to be continuing so long. I think they do present a barrier, not just to parents, obviously, but also to children and their participation. Likewise, I would be concerned if virtual consultations with between child welfare reporters and children continued. That said, and this is a discussion that's happening around children's hearing service as well, in some cases, the use of virtual technology can be an enabling factor for children and young people. It can allow a different type of participation for them. It can be more comfortable for them. But when the decisions are made about that, that needs to be based on the child's best interests and the needs and their views on it, not on what's convenient for the system. And I think that is a concern, is that these technologies that we've all got so used to using become a default because it's easier rather than better. On the topic of training, I think that is an ongoing issue. It's interesting that in other countries compulsory training seems to be in place. It's around ensuring the consistency in knowledge and understanding and training of children's needs and their rights.
Thank you. And Marcia?
Yes, thanks. We will be talking extensively tomorrow about the question of virtual trials and hearings. And I really want to point out to the committee, well, first of all, that I think the system is uncomfortable with virtual trials and hearings, but I am not clear that the evidence is there to say that it is not a good option, a better option than dealing with the existing delays that are absolutely growing like a virus in our system. And justice delayed is justice denied. We have multiple cases, and I suggest maybe inviting ASSIST to come and speak to the committee, which is a court advocacy service in Glasgow, about children. We know of one where a child is now involved in a case who, by the time it comes to court, 3 years will have passed. And you can imagine what an impact that has on a child waiting to come to court for 3 years. Also, there has been a pilot trial in Grampian of virtual trials there for domestic abuse. And we know that the recommendation and has been accepted by the Lord President would be for virtual domestic abuse courts in every sheriffdom in Scotland, not just to address the backlog, but because there is so much evidence that evidence is better taken from witnesses and victims in the context where you're not putting a victim in the same room as her abuser. And civil proceedings are particularly egregious because victims are always in the same room with their abuser. Screens and other special measures are rarely allowed by sheriffs because they want the setting to be more informal. And children's views, children do not often want to be in those rooms, but that does not mean they don't want to have a view and to have that view taken with its due weight. And so I think the question is, how do we make all kinds of hearings work for children rather than rushing back to in-person hearings based on the comfort of the adults in the system?
Okay, thank you. And can I go to Leslie, please?
Hi, thank you. I was just to respond on a couple of points there. My understanding, and I practice all across Scotland, is that WebEx for child welfare hearings is the norm, not teleconference hearings. The difficulty with the teleconference hearing is that you can't see each other. From an advocacy point of view, you can't see, for example, what papers the sheriff has. I had written an article actually about virtual advocacy, including the issues in telephone hearings. In terms of if you're faced with a telephone hearing, I would always ask the sheriff clerk to ensure that your client is given the telephone number so they can also dial in, because I think Ruth was talking about the issue of parties being excluded. So across Scotland, the norm is WebEx rather than a telephone hearing. In terms of the children's views, sheriffs have this at the forefront of their mind, in my experience, and you can't lodge a writ now without an F9 form. So the F9 form is put in children's language and sent to the court with the application before the sheriff will even grant warrant to serve. And then the court is also going to consider how best to take the child's views. There was a case actually last year decided in the Lord Malcolm in the Inner House, and it makes reference again to section 117B and article 12 in terms of the weight to be placed on child's views and the requirement to take a child's views. And the result of that has been that I've been instructed to interview children as young as four, and regularly the court wants the child's views taken on, even if there's a slight variation to a contact order. So in my experience, the court is very well aware that a child's views require to be taken and consideration is given as to how best those views are taken.
you. And Judith as well, please.
Thank you so much. I just want to pick up on a couple of things which have been mentioned. Marsha certainly mentioned other stakeholders, and as I was preparing to come here and was going through the agenda, it certainly occurred to me, first of all, that we also have the children's hearing system and the fairly recent legislation that opened up the possibility of anyone who's concerned about a child to make a referral to the children's reporter. So access is seemingly more direct as opposed to being reliant on going through social work or education, then being the gateway to that that referral. So it may be worth giving consideration to getting feedback from the Scottish Children's Reporters Administration, because they, generally speaking, will deal with, the most vulnerable children and the most vulnerable parents. Flowing from that, we've already mentioned how children's views are taken. We have the F9 form, which was recently modified and the procedure was updated. A child can instruct a solicitor, and we've heard about the challenges involving the availability of solicitors to act for children. But also clan child law came to mind as somebody who might be, or an organisation who might be a stakeholder to consult their Scotland's Law Centre for Children and Young People. And their input may be welcomed. I think a few of the other things that were occurring to me was that it is important to have a child-centred approach to this for family court cases, and that's really where the society, the Law Society, and the subcommittee had been coming from. There are positives and negatives to the increased use of technology. The impact that a sheriff can have when a sheriff is speaking to the parties directly shouldn't really be underestimated. An experienced sheriff who deals with these types of cases on a daily basis, speaking to parties directly, losing that, I think, has, through the phone call type hearings where the parents haven't been included. I appreciate now that, solicitors are, should be aware that they can request that their client's there, but there have been hearings when parents haven't even heard what's going on. So, highlighting just the impact that a sheriff's, comments can have to parents. Let's be sensible about this. This is your child we're talking about. It's quite important. So the technological side of things, there are, as I've said, positives and negatives. A child can feel, for instance, safer with a camera switched off and speaking to somebody. A remote hearing can be easier for a child or a parent practically and emotionally. A child might be able to give their views, for example, from a safe place like school, or a recorded statement being given. So it's important to consider each case and the needs of the child. And, it certainly occurs to us that the court rules could be updated to require this to be considered at the case management hearings. Older children are obviously more capable of engaging remotely, I think it's something that has been mentioned already, but consideration should perhaps also be given to asking the child how they want their views to be taken. At the moment, we very much see the adults making that decision, the sheriff, the decision maker, but asking the child, these are the options, how would you feel?
Okay, thank you. And Roseanne, and then I'm then going to go to Karen, and if folk who've still got something to say can just come in after that. So, Roseanne.
Yeah, I just really wanted to say about the F9 form. I think it, even although it's been redrafted in a child-friendly fashion, sending a child or young person a form and expecting them to... I'm speechless that we think that that's even an OK way to get a child's views. So I just have to say that.
Thanks very much. Thanks for keeping that quick as well. We're tight on time, actually, in terms of the other areas that committee members want to cover. So if we could all try, these are big topics, so I totally understand that. So Karen Adam, please.
Thank you, convener. And thank you to the panel. We know that coercive control and abuse often escalates and intensifies post-marriage separation, family separation. And we now know that the pandemic has increased the ability of such control to take place. We've had parents and children share their lived experience of family members continuing to exercise abuse and coercive control upon children post-separation through court processes and contact arrangements. Was coercive behaviour during periods of lockdown and the pandemic generally seen in the justice system? And is the system equipped and the people in it trained in regards to coercive control? Are the signs easily spotted? Are they looked for? And also, was access to justice hindered because of this? Could I start as to Dr. Scott, please?
I think, fair to the system, which I'm often very critical of, figuring out how to suddenly become sensitive to perpetrators' use of the courts in furthering their abuse, particularly, as you pointed out, in post-separation proceedings, in the middle of a pandemic, something they didn't do very well when they weren't dealing with a pandemic, is probably unrealistic. But I will say that we heard, and our sister agencies, Victim Support and Assist, also many, many cases in which the system was incapable, both police and the civil processes, in acting in a timely manner. We had one instance, for instance, when a perpetrator had the child for a visitation and then didn't bring the child back for over a month afterwards, claiming multiple COVID exposures. And the system didn't have a tool with which to respond to the risk in that. Your questions about is the court able to identify coercive control and respond to it in civil courts? Our experience, to be honest, at the moment is not yet. We do know that all of the sheriffs and judges were trained in the new law. Thank you, Lord Carloway, for making that mandatory. But anybody who knows anything about the effectiveness and the duration of effect of training knows that a one-off training is unlikely to create behavior change or even attitude and understanding change without, infrastructure and accountability, neither of which we have at the moment. Women and children are telling us, and there are pockets of excellence in the system, I have to just say, but that in general, their experiences of court are still as re-traumatizing and as frightening as they ever have been, and that many, many victims will never report again because of that.
Okay, back to Karen, I think.
Yeah, could I ask Judith, same question, please?
Thank you so much. So your first question is around coercive control and abuse. Is it easily spotted? I mean, I think there are always going to be challenges around these types of things. I don't think that any of us are particularly well educated over this. And I think education and training from the judiciary to the practitioners to, everybody involved in cases involving children would be very useful. It's a very nuanced area, and it's such a complicated, web that can be created, and unpacking that for individual relationships can be quite complicated. And, the police, for instance, are they equipped to really kind of, have these things flagged up, So I mean, it's happening. It's there. You know, I personally have clients who have symptoms of these types of relationships. And, you know, I had personally set aside some time to do some training on narcissistic personality disorder, for instance, you know, to inform my practice. But one of the things that I have come across in the work that I do with coaches and family therapists is that what they're saying is it's often quite highly educated people. You know, it's not the lower socioeconomic, you know, part of society that, I mean, that can be there, absolutely, but it is prevalent across, you know, all socioeconomic aspects of society. And, you know, it's not something which, you know, discriminates by wealth. So isn't it therefore much more important to address?
Thank you very much, Convener. I'll leave it there, but I look forward to us working on this further in the future.
Thank you. There's a few other folk indicated they want to come on this topic. So, Megan, please.
Thank you. I think in terms of coercive control and domestic abuse, Marsha's spoken very clearly on what the situation with the courts is in terms of the adults involved. I think we're probably even further behind in recognising the impact on children and young people. Even when we were looking at the 2020 Act, it was very much on an incident-based model. It was if the child is present, a child is all in a situation of coercive control. If there's a child in the house, they're present, because the whole point of that definition of coercive control is recognising the pervasiveness of that form of domestic abuse. So I think there's probably an even bigger hill to climb in terms of the awareness of the impact on children. And secondly, can I just thank Roseanne for raising the issue on the F9 form with, on a long-standing basis, being clear of our concerns about its use as a way of gathering the views of children, particularly because if there's one thing that could be influenced, it would probably be filling out a form that you didn't understand in the first place and needed help from someone with. The measures that are in the 2020 Act are intended to completely replace rather than supplement it. It shouldn't be seen as a first step. I would very much hope we were looking at it being phased out very quickly.
Okay, thank you. And then we're going to go to Leslie and then back to Ian.
Thank you. The F9 form, I made reference to that because the court requires the F9 form to be made available before the action is lodged. Personally, as a child welfare reporter who regularly interviews children, I don't think an F9 form is a way to get a child's views for the reasons that are already given, but that's what the court rules require. So I think the court should, at the outset, consider how the child's views should best be taken. But that's my personal view as a practitioner. And I just wanted to say, in regard to coercive control, that the Family Law Association organised training, and as part of our ADM conference this year, we had Nazeen Martin speak about being a trauma-aware practitioner. That is something that's at the forefront of everybody's mind at the moment in terms of awareness to these kinds of issues, both as a practitioner and also in terms of the other aspects of my role. And you will often have clients who come into the office, and when you ask them, for example, what do you want to happen, there's complete radio silence. So as Judith says, this is something that you come across, you know, regularly, and it's something to be aware of and how you can best represent a client. And also, as a child welfare reporter, be alert to these issues in terms of the best interests of the child, because what we're talking about here at court proceedings is the court is only interested in what's in the best interests of the child. That's their paramount consideration. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. And Ian?
Yes. The F9 form is a lot better than it used to be, but it's still totally inadequate to expect a child of various ages to understand. CAFCAS, the Children and Family Court Advisory Service in England and Wales, have been doing a lot of work on this, and they have young people's advisory boards working with them. And they've been looking at ways in which children can send little video clips, children can do drawings, all sorts of things. And so we should view the F9 form as purely being a temporary process which could be vastly improved. And specialist sheriffs is another topic, I think, that we're talking about a very difficult job being undertaken by these sheriffs. In some Scottish courts, you do have specialist family sheriffs doing a really good job. A lot of other sheriff courts in Scotland, you're just getting the same sheriff doing all the other processes. And this is where I think there is an equality of opportunities. Why should, if you go to a court in Lerwick or Thurso, whatever, you don't get a family sheriff, whereas you do in Edinburgh and Glasgow and cities? So we could, and this is where the triage that I was talking about at the start, coupled with the existing case management changes that are being gradually introduced, could mean that we get experienced family sheriffs dealing with the hardest cases in the court.
OK, thank you very much. We'll now move to Alexander Stewart, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you very much for your comments so far. It has been quite enlightening. You've talked about today that the access issues that are present. You've also talked about the insensitivity issues that are present and the backlog that we've experienced because of the pandemic. So it'd be quite good to get the views, possibly of Megan and Roseanne first, about the family justice modernisation strategy that has been put in place. Now, does that go far enough in trying to challenge and tackle some of these issues that we have identified this morning? Because that is the next step, or would be seen as the next step, for us to progress some of this. And if there are still gaps, and if there are still fears that that's not going to achieve what you're expecting it to achieve, then there needs to be follow-up and some scrutiny and governance about how that process would go forward. So if maybe Megan and then Roseanne. Thank you. Thank you.
I think, to be fair to the civil servants in the Scottish Government, there has been a disruption across every part of Scottish Government over the last 2.5 years, and not just because of the pandemic. There has also been other things going on which have impacted on their workload. I think the Family Justice Modernisation Strategy is a good starting point. I think there's going to be opportunities to discuss how things can be improved. I think it's positive that we are acknowledging that our family justice system needs to be modernised. Incorporation of the UNCRC and later of other UN human rights treaties, I think, will necessitate having a look again at the current proposals, but also actually just the fact that time's elapsed as a result of 2 years of or more of disruption to normal work. And that's not just the government officials' normal work, it's all of our normal work in terms of the day-to-day job, I think will mean that it probably does need a mini review. But I think that's probably a really positive thing, because I think lots of learnings happened in the last 2 years.
I don't think I could have put it much better. Actually, yes, so I would agree with Megan. I think we heard quite a lot about the Family Justice Modernisation Strategy prior to COVID, and then since then there's been the Children Scotland Act and the secondary legislation, and that seems to have been the focus of conversation. So I'm not actually sure. I think a review of that and what needs to be kind of amended in that would be worth doing at this point in time, yeah. But I think there's still the people think that the Children Scotland Act happened and it's in place, but actually there was a lot that still I had a researcher contact me and say, oh, now that there's these ADR pilot meetings, how has that impacted on families? And I said, there's been absolutely zero change, because we're still talking about a pilot. So, you know, a lot of what was in the Act hasn't actually had an impact yet.
And I don't know if anyone else wants to answer anything, Convener, on that. If not, I'm content.
Could I maybe say that these questions are being asked across the world. There are judiciaries and national judiciaries all over the world looking at exactly these things. And countries, Singapore has moved to a sort of more of a problem-solving approach to family cases. Similar-sized country to Scotland, maybe not quite the same as Scotland, but you know, their judges are doing that now. So they're looking just in the way that we've done problem-solving in drug and alcohol courts, so that it's not about working out who's right and who's wrong, but it is about working about what is going to be best for the children. And the other thing that's happened internationally is that sometimes there have been trials, not trials in terms of court cases, but experiments with, let's see if we do it this way. Australia quite often has tried things out before they introduce them. And I think that is, it's difficult to do within a court system, but it is possible to try things. And there is going to be the trial of the ADR, the alternative dispute resolution processes. So we also lack a lot of data about actually the numbers of cases, the amount of time, the amount of cost in the Scottish courts. We need more data on that.
Ed, and I think Marcia was wanting to come in.
Yeah, just to briefly say, we've had lots of conversations both at the Victims Task Force and also in some of the COVID emergency work within the justice system about the delays to some of the modernization agenda. And there's a number of things that, if actually implemented with some speed, would make an enormous difference to the experiences of victims and children in the courts, including pre-recorded interviews, evidence by commission, a whole variety of things that we keep hearing are too expensive or too difficult to do, and yet we spend, you know, millions and millions of pounds on hearings, that many of which never go forward, get postponed, etc. The other thing I just wanted to pick up was Rosanna's comment early on about risk assessment in the decision making about awarding contact, and I really want to point to that as a fault in the system, which is then cascading down to all these problems, many of which we've been discussing today. And that, you know, we really believe that contact should never be ordered unless it's manifestly clear that the child and the non-offending parent are safe in that contact. And the reason we have contact centers is because those orders get made all the time when it's not manifestly clear that it's safe. So I do think that we should consider about contact centers as a stopgap rather to, you know, a short-term approach to safety rather than as an answer to safety.
Okay, thank you. And we're now going to Fulton McGregor, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to all the panel. Thanks very much for your evidence so far. I think it's been a really, really interesting session. And in fact, a lot of the areas that I was going to ask about have already had quite a good hearing. And I think that's just been down to the nature of the flexible nature of the way that the meeting's been convened and the way people have asked questions. However, with that said, I still would like to ask some questions on some of the points that I know we've already spoke about them. Children's participation, we've spoken about that a wee bit. It's a really, really big issue. It's a really big issue for me when we took the bill through in the last parliament. And I'm wondering if any of the panellists who maybe haven't had a chance to articulate their points on this could suggest to the committee ways in which we think we could get children's voices to be more heard through the family law process. And I know, convener, you're asking members to ask a panelist to speak, but I'm not sure if there's somebody that maybe would like to come back in on this issue who's not already had the opportunity.
Okay.
I've spoken about it, but I'm not sure I can add very much. I certainly agree with what other speakers have said about the use of the Form F9. I did my dissertation on the Form F9 in 1999, and it only changed last year, and it's still a form, or not last year, it's, you know, recently. That definitely needs to be changed. We need to be looking at, you know, how do children want to participate in proceedings? Let's find out. Let's see what would be most appropriate for them. And I think the pandemic certainly has moved things forward in terms of everybody's use of technology. How can that be harnessed in order to improve participation?
Thank you. If I could now go to Leslie, please.
Thank you. One of the options that's available to the court is actually to appoint a curatrix to represent the child in court proceedings. That's not done normally, but it can be done if things are particularly complex, and it tends to be for an older child. And I do have cases ongoing just now where that works really well, because the curatrix is there simply to represent the child and interview the child regularly, and then the child's views are conveyed through the curatrix, who's also representing the child's interests in the court proceedings, if that makes sense. So that is another option that's available, and it can work really well. Other than the court, the child being interviewed by an independent person, such as a child welfare reporter, and also spoken about the AF9 form.
Okay, thank you. And now Megan, please.
Thank you. I realise I've already spoken at this on this issue, so thank you for letting me come back in. I think there are some real opportunities in terms of implementing the 2020 Act. I'm concerned to hear that courts are requiring the F9 form, and I'm hoping that that will not last very much longer. I think there is an opportunity for, as part of the Family Justice Modernisation Strategy, to not see this as a job done, but to actually continue to develop the way that we hear children's views and allow them to participate in proceedings. There's the flexibility in the Act to allow different professionals to take on that role. I think that was, there was a lot of discussion about which professionals. I think actually it's useful to have flexibility for whatever is appropriate for that particular child in terms of profession of the reporter. And I think there's possibly even a larger discussion could be had around what is the role of a child welfare reporter or a curator ad litem, and looking at some of the models that are used in other jurisdictions. Australia and New Zealand both have models around children's lawyers, and it varies from state to state in Australia, and there might be quite a lot of learning available there. And the final thing is, I think it would be useful to have some more research on collecting the views of very young children and some capacity building around how that's achieved. I think it's something that often is seen as a problem because we don't properly understand how to do it. However, there's good practice out there in other areas, and I think there's an opportunity to build the capacity. I don't think it's reasonable to expect the professionals currently working in that area to necessarily have it, because it is a relatively new concept to the law, but I think there's lots of potential there.
And Marsha.
A couple of things. One is, I think we should be making sure that we keep a really close eye on BANTIF's work. We know that that children experiencing domestic abuse are included in the list of constituencies for use for being supported in the BANTIF's model. And I think there's going to be so much learning from that about how we can fix other elements of the system. The F9 form, I don't want to beat a dead horse here, but I will just say that there was an extensive work, and I think Megan, the Children's Commissioner's Office, was, and you probably were involved in this then, consulting young people about what they wanted and how they wanted to be consulted. And they said, don't use that form, ask us. And that alternative was rejected at the time. By the courts system, and I think that one of the problems that we have in the system right now is we do not have the infrastructure for children and young people to participate in development and design work. So we get to this stage where we're having discussions like this about why don't we know how children would like to do this, because we didn't involve them early enough in the process. We have asked that the Justice help set up a standing children and young people's participation group, which we had prior to this, and we did with the Children's Commission, to feedback on justice matters, because we can't just pull surviving children out of our pockets and expect them to be in a place where they can engage with the system on any kind of an equal basis. And yet we have standing survivor groups for adults, and we have a survivors reference group for adults. Really suggest that if the committee wants to be able to get ongoing rights-based information from children and young people about the system and how they want to participate, that we need to fund that standing group And we have, you know, worked with other stakeholders to volunteer to help support that, but we can't do it without some funding. And just Megan, on your point, Mothers in Mind is a project in Canada that works specifically with children under four, and I'm happy to connect you with some of that work. It's very interesting. And also the child advocacy program, which was part of the 2020 Act, there's been no evidence that it's actually moving at any fast pace or even a slow pace. And the difficulty is, that's what children told us in Power Up, Power Down with the Children's Commission, was the single most important thing that they needed to interact with the system, which was an advocate that they trusted. And it doesn't, you know, it doesn't have to be a Women's Aid children's worker, although it could be, but the child advocacy system really needs to have to be higher up in the priorities for implementation, because we can pass these things in law, but unless they're actually made real in children's lives, then it's just sticking plasters. Thanks.
Thank you. And Ian?
Just like to point out to the committee that although we've mentioned domestic abuse and coercive control a lot in this discussion, many of the cases that happen in the family courts either don't involve that at all, they're simply a dispute between parents, or they involve allegations which may or may not be upheld. So I think you've got, when you're considering this court involvement in sorting disputes between parents, domestic abuse is an important factor, and both men and women commit domestic abuse in some instances. But you can't design the entire system on the basis of that. You've got to think about what's best overall for all the cases going in the court.
Thank you. Can we just go back to Fulton just to check that he's happy with?
Hey, thanks, Convener. I had one follow-up question, but I think we did this one then.
Sorry, Judith. Sorry.
Oh, thank you so much. Just to feed into the conversation, I had recent experience of the court sending out an F9 form for a child aged 3. Now, that was a training issue for that particular clerk. My understanding, having reviewed the legislation, is that the F9 is appropriately used for children of school age, 5 and over. So that type of thing has happened. And, you know, I think the F9 form, you know, I think there's a general consensus it's not a particularly good way of taking children's views. Just to also add in that I think it's important to take a balanced approach in terms of making quick decisions, and I'm going to borrow a bit from education here to get it right for every child. An informed decision is more likely to be a better decision. So I think a balance ought to be there between, you know, making really quick decisions, which are obviously important to do for children, but obviously making a good decision, you know, for a child that's informed by the relationships around that child. Thank you so much.
And Roseanne wants to come in.
Yeah, thank you. I think we have really clear feedback from children that they want to meet with a person, and getting a form through the post is not the way for them to be able to express their views. So we've got really clear evidence of that, and I think that what you're talking about there is it needs to be more than just a short conversation as well. All of our mediators that meet with children will have at least 2 meetings with them, and it's about exploring their experience. It's not about answering a particular question that the court might have identified. So I think it's a bigger thing. It's specialist work. It needs to be done by people that know what they're doing.
Okay, thank you. And back to Fulton McGregor briefly.
Thanks, Convener. I did have follow-up questions on welfare reporters and contact centres, but I think the issues have been extensively covered, Convener, and in the interest of time, I'm happy to leave it at that.
Okay, thank you. I see you wanted to come in, over you? Fine. Okay, there's a few other areas that we haven't managed to cover, but I think we've gone round a lot of issues there in depth, and I think there's quite a few things for the committee to look at how we might take forward
So thank you all so much for your evidence set today, and we'll now suspend briefly before moving into private session. Thank you.